Welcome to the Resilience Training Program, a project created by Seniors Action Quebec, sponsored by Canadian Heritage. This is the first of a six-part series on resilience training. My name is Mirella Castricchini, and I would like to share this program with you, and I hope that what you learn through this training will help you grow and develop your resilience skills. Each of the modules contain a general theoretical review on the topic, exercises, and a few scenarios to explore issues that are frequently encountered by seniors. We also include a list of resources that are available in the community to address these issues. Finally, all references are listed at the end of the module, and we encourage you to explore those that interest you the most. What is the Resilience Training Program? It is a Seniors Action Quebec project sponsored by Canadian Heritage. A little about our organization. Seniors Action Quebec is a nonprofit organization that works to maintain and enhance the vitality of English-speaking seniors. Its mission is to identify and address challenges and issues in order to promote a healthy and active lifestyle for English-speaking seniors. Why a resilience training program? The resilience training program is a response to some of the concerns raised in several discussions and exchanges within the English-speaking communities throughout Quebec. Those concerns included feeling marginalized in certain communities, feeling less supported, and at times more vulnerable and intimidated living in a minority, and not feeling confident in building a social network of support. And so the goal is to build a stronger, more vibrant English-speaking seniors network who will be better equipped to engage with the wider community. The objectives are to provide a series of resilience skills trainings to English-speaking seniors that will build confidence, nurture self-advocacy, and promote community engagement. Here are the topics we will be looking at in this module. Take a moment to review and know that you can click on any one to jump directly to the topic without having to scroll through the whole presentation for a second look. The learning objectives are: self-awareness is a fundamental skill to developing the seven competencies of resilience training. To gain a better understanding of self-awareness, learn the benefits and barriers of self-awareness. Applying the Johari Window model to explore aspects of self-awareness. Using powerful questions to self-coach through challenging events. Learn activities and methods to practice self-awareness. So, what is resilience? Resilience is the quality of recovering quickly from failure and adversity, and not only returning to what was, but using the opportunity to grow. From falling off the horse to getting back in the saddle in times of sickness and uncertainty to healthier days ahead. Resilience and learning. Can resilience be taught? Psychology today states that many factors that determine resilience, such as genetics, early life experiences, and luck, can't be modified. But specific resilience-building skills still can be learned. Education in later life. Older learners are motivated to engage in learning when what is being presented is something that is personally significant or meaningful to them, and that the learning activity serves to improve the skills, abilities, or competencies. Hopefully, this module will indeed contribute to improving your resilience skills. Seven competencies of resilience training. This training program borrows from the model of the seven competencies of resilience that was first published by the American Academy of Pediatrics in 2006. We will be adapting the model to this training in order to meet the objectives of the program. Let's go through those seven competencies. First being competence, knowing you can handle a situation effectively by recognizing your strengths. Confidence, belief in your own abilities, is derived by competence. Connection, developing close ties to family and community creates a solid sense of security. Character, a composite of traits that demonstrate a caring attitude toward others and self. Behavior, guided by morals and values. Contribution, understanding of the values of personal contribution can serve as a source for purpose and motivation. Coping, learning how to cope with stress. And finally, control, understanding what is within one's control and what is not. Now that we know what the competencies of resilience are, how do we begin building? Now we begin the second part of this module to introduce the concept of self-awareness and how it serves as a fundamental skill to building resilience. What is self-awareness? According to the World Health Organization, life skills are behaviors that enable individuals to adapt and deal effectively with the demands and challenges of life, self-awareness being one of them. Let's look at the first of two definitions that provide a comprehension definition of self-awareness. The American Psychological Association states that self-awareness involves being aware of different aspects of the self, including traits, behaviors, and feelings. Essentially, it is a psychological state in which oneself becomes the focus of attention. The second definition is an understanding about yourself and how you respond to your world. It includes recognition of the self, our character, our strengths and weaknesses, desires and dislikes, as well as for developing empathy with others. Why is self-awareness so important? Let's take a look at some of the benefits. Self-awareness allows you to control your behavior. It helps us to understand our needs and limitations and how best to address them. It increases our capacity to question our beliefs and how to evaluate how and if they are reflective of whom we truly are or desire to be. Helps you cope with stress and face difficult situations. And finally, develops empathy. Self-awareness means asking yourself, how well do I know myself? What more can I learn? Psychologists break self-awareness down to two different types. The first one being public self-awareness. This type of self-awareness compels people to adhere to social norms. We become aware that we are being watched and evaluated, and as a result, we adjust our behavior to be socially acceptable. Private self-awareness happens when people become aware of some aspects of themselves, but only in a private way. Seeing your face in the mirror is a type of private self-awareness, or feeling your stomach lurch when you realize you forgot to do something important, or simply feeling your heart flutter when you see someone you are attracted to. In this first exercise called How Self-Aware Am I? You are asked to read each statement and rate your response from 1 to 5, 1 being disagree to 5 agree. Then add up your scores and enter the total at the bottom in the overall total. Then enter the total scores for the questions corresponding to the private self, that is, questions 1, 3, 5, and 7. And proceed to enter the total score for the questions corresponding to the public self, that is, questions 2, 4, 6, and 8. The objective of the exercise is to provide some feedback on how self-aware you are. The higher you score, the more self-aware you tend to be. The Johari Window. The Johari Window was created by psychologists Joseph Luff and Harrington Ingram. It is a psychological model that helps people understand their relationship with themselves and others. It is divided in four areas or quadrants, as we can see here. So let's take a closer look at each area to get a better sense of the model and how it can be used as a tool to explore self-awareness. The first quadrant, named the open area, contains information, and that is what is known by the person about him or herself and is also known by others. For example, your birthday or languages you speak, where you live, your pet's name, as well as feelings, motives, wants, and needs. The more I am willing to tell you about myself, the better you will get to know and understand me. The second quadrant is labeled the blind area. This is the area that is explained as information that is unknown by the person about him or herself, but that which is known to others. For example, you may have been told that you blush when you meet somebody new, or that you tend to play with your hair when you're anxious about something. These are things that others are aware of, but you may fail to see in yourself. The third quadrant. These might include characteristics that we hide from others, either intentionally or simply due to situations or events, therefore known to yourself, not known to others. The fourth quadrant, we see characteristics that appear only in certain situations and are not known to us or to others before they actually occur. They can be behaviors, attitudes, or feelings that may have been quite close to the surface, but not exposed until a situation or event occurs. For example, standing up to a bully on the spot when it's something you have never thought of having the courage to do, or leading a group of people out of a burning building. And so to review, the principles of the Johari window are that self-disclosure reduces the hidden area, feedback reduces the blind area, together they reduce the unknown area. Now, how does the Johari window relate to resilience? As defined earlier, resilience is the ability to adapt, cope, overcome adversity, and grow from the experience. The more you know about yourself and your relationship with others, the better equipped you are to face your challenges and build resilience. This next exercise is called filling in your toolbox. Take the next few minutes to reflect on your own toolbox. What do you know about your strengths, weaknesses, values, and beliefs? You may want to have a separate sheet of paper to record your answers. So here is an inventory of adjectives to describe strengths. Take a couple of minutes to list those that you feel best describe you. After you're done, go on to the next exercise. Here is an inventory of adjectives to describe weaknesses. Take a couple of minutes to list those that you feel best describe you, then move on to the next exercise. In this exercise, we ask you to reflect on your values in the three areas, your personal, societal, and professional area. Add as many values that reflect who you are. No value is exclusive to one area, so they may cross from one area to another. And finally, take a moment to complete what your core beliefs are. Again, add any other that is not listed here. Now, with the use of this previous exercise, produce your own Johari window. Just a note, of course, you're not capable of completing the blind area. However, you may want to ask a trusted friend to give you some feedback. This will reduce your unknown area and increase your known to self area. What more would you like to know about yourself, and who can you trust to ask? Here is another exercise that may elicit some thoughts during this difficult time. How do you handle difficult situations? Think of a challenging event that you have experienced in the past or that you are currently experiencing. For example, the COVID-19 pandemic, being confined or having to rely on others for grocery shopping, or not seeing your family and friends. Use your toolbox to help you in your reflection. Here are three questions to get you started on your reflection. 1. What do you know about yourself that enables you to handle a difficult, unexpected event? What would your friends or family say about how you handled yourself during that crisis? And 3. What did you learn about yourself during that time? What now? Now that we have learned about self-awareness, how can you use it to your advantage? How is this related to resilience? Having learned a little more about yourself may have made it easier for you to see that you possess many qualities that have made you resilient through the years. Growing your resilience is the objective of this program, but in addition to having resilient qualities, having the resources to reach out is equally important to achieve a healthy quality of life. As explained by Dr. Michael Unger, researcher and chair of the Resilience Institute of Dalhousie University, there is a need for structures to be in place for people to have a structure to lean on. Having the resources to reach out to increase the likelihood of the individual to get what they need in order to overcome challenging situations. For example, having community centers with special programs for seniors, community food banks, or affordable housing programs. In his book, Change Your World, The Science of Resilience and the True Path to Success, Dr. Unger states that people living in challenging contexts change when their natural supports, programs and interventions, and social policies help them navigate effectively, negotiate effectively, and find resources that are culturally and contextually meaningful. In this next section of the module, we will be looking at some of the issues seniors face and the questions they have to getting the resources they need. Though the dialogue is brief, it serves to illustrate how some problems can be resolved given the proper resources. And the key message here is that reaching out for support is both effective and empowering. It is one of the competencies of resilience.
I'm really having a hard time asking for help, but I know that being too proud to reach out will not get me what I need. I would like to receive help, please.
Hello, and thank you for calling. What challenges are you facing today?
My current financial issues are troubling me.
Are you receiving your guaranteed income supplement with your old age pension? And are you aware that you'll be receiving a COVID-19 emergency benefit?
Yes, but it's not enough.
Would getting access to a food bank help you? Here's a website link to help you find the nearest food bank. Keep in mind, they may ask you some personal questions, and they may ask you to bring some documents with you. Ask them anything that you may have concerning the services and how soon you can get them. If you have any other questions, don't hesitate to call me back.
Thank you so much.
As a caregiver, I'm looking for some guidance. I need to call for help.
Hello, how can I help you today?
I need help regarding my mom. I think she may need to be placed.
Do you have a social worker? Okay, the first thing you should do is call your local CLSC and they will guide you on what to do next.
I'm a little confused. Can you walk me through what I should be expecting on that phone call? My French is not very good and I want to be prepared if there is no one available to help me in English.
Certainly. First thing, an assessment will be conducted to establish what her care needs are and to determine if you qualify for permanent placement. Placement is based on a priority level, not first come, first served.
Okay, so I understand that I will need to contact my CLSC to get an assessment started. This is going to be very difficult for me. I have been taking care of my mother for 5 years and I am exhausted. Is there something I can do as a caregiver?
Yes, there are some organizations that help caregivers like yourself.
Thank you for the links. I wasn't aware of the resources available to me in English.
And here are a few more resources that may help you. Be sure to check their website or call your local community organization to help you navigate the services you need. We have come to the end of the module, and having covered quite a bit of information, let's review some of the important points to remember. First, the goal of the Resilience Training Program is to provide resilience skills training to English-speaking seniors, skills that will help seniors to gain confidence, to self-advocate, and minimize isolation by building social network of support in the community. That resilience is the ability to recover and grow from adversity. We introduce the concept of self-awareness as a fundamental skill to begin building resilience. Self-awareness is a life skill that makes us aware of our behavior, feelings, attitudes, and traits. And with the Johari Window model, we examined how in tune we are with ourselves, as well as learning that by opening ourselves up to feedback decreases our blind area. Recognizing our strengths and weaknesses, values and beliefs is a good starting point to getting to know the tools you have to begin developing your resilience. Finally, aside from developing resilience skills, finding the resources to reach out in difficult times increases the likelihood of our ability to deal with or to overcome challenges. And so I'd like to end our first module by quoting Charles Darwin. "It's not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the ones most responsive to change." So thank you for your interest in this topic. I hope you're leaving with more information about yourself and self-awareness. The appendix in the following slides are also some additional exercises and activities which can deepen some of your learning. As for the resources, know that there are several organizations not listed here that are also available to you and your friends in time of need. If you don't know where to start, always try your CLSC or local community center. There are many people trained and ready to help you. All you need to do is reach out. Thank you.